In 3 bis 4 Tagen war ein Mensch kein Mensch mehr, nur noch ein Stückchen Knochen mit einer Uniform oder irgendwelchen Klamotten bedeckt. Wir hörten jede Nacht die Schakale, aber ich möchte sagen, das ist weniger der Arbeit dieser Viecher gewesen als eben der Würmer.
Schwarz. Denn alles, was so rosarot war, ist jetzt schwarz. Oh, sag mir doch, was ist mit uns denn nur geschehen? Warum muss ich jetzt alles schwarz in schwarz versehen?
With the end of World War II, a new period in history began with the Cold War. Looking back from today, this switch of scenario can seem rather abrupt. For the people living at the time, and especially Germans, this abrupt switch was not the reality. The soldiers of the Wehrmacht found themselves in a vastly different world after 5 years of total war. Germany was split in two and had no military up until the mid to late 50s. So what happened with these up to 16 million men who fought for the Wehrmacht and the Waffen-SS? Many of them found themselves not only in a new historical period, but also in POW camps, and at best could return to a home that was ruined and a political culture and society that can be at best described as nihilistic. Luckily for some of them, the end of general military conflict did not end at World War II. Quite the opposite. The end of World War II destabilized not only Europe, but also the entire colonial world with their respective empires clinging onto themselves to keep themselves alive. One of these empires was France, with its attempt to hold onto its Indochina colony in Algeria. For this, they needed men. Additionally, with the decolonization of Africa, this led to many African armies desiring skilled white men that can help them in their cause. With around 16 million Germans with combat experience, to assume that some were ready to use these conflicts as an opportunity should not be surprising. In this video, we will look how, where, and why Germans after World War II decided to become mercenaries in organizations like the French Foreign Legion. Ideology, money, the urge for adventure, and the plain addiction to war will all be inspected here, in all its honest, brutal, and sometimes comedic layers.
They must find it a strange sort of life, so different from what they'd been led to expect. They were told of cruelty and brutality to prisoners, yet here they are ruling themselves with their own instructions.
France came out of the Second World War as the weakest victorious nation. This led them into a rather undesirable geopolitical position. The empire was unstable on all fronts. While the early revolts in Algeria were stomped down rather quickly, the Viet Minh, who were heavily supplied and even had contracts with the United States for their efforts against the Japanese, were a bigger issue in their Indochina colony. To stabilize the situation, it required manpower, and no other part of the French forces was more important for this than the French Foreign Legion. To sum up what the FFL was very quickly, it was a separate section of the French armed forces that anyone from Europe could apply to and serve in protecting the furthest French frontiers. The problem? Many men who joined right before World War II and during World War II were anti-fascists and often Jewish refugees who had very little interest staying in the Legion beyond the war. At the same time, conveniently, almost 765,000 Wehrmacht and SS prisoners of war were in France. Filling up the lack of manpower with these men was tempting for military leaders. Before this, some Germans already sneaked into the Legion because, while Germans were still banned, prisoners of war from other Axis powers and Austrians were already allowed. This included non-German members of the Waffen-SS. On the 20th of January, the Legion finally got the permission of recruitment, and 21 days later they already got slapped down with a warning to not recruit Waffen-SS members and high war criminals. This can be interpreted in many ways, none being really confirmable. One way one could interpret this is that a massive amount of SS people did join and that this then spread rumors, or alternatively, it's also realistic that this myth was started by the media because it can make good headlines. The reality of SS men in the Legion is probably somewhere in the middle of both of these, and in general it was tough for hardened SS men to get into the Legion after this warning. So the majority of Germans were primarily Wehrmacht. The reason why the narrative of SS men in the Legion became so popular is because, for one, it makes sense. The men of the SS could not expect the same treatment when they came home to Germany as the Wehrmacht. Many men of the SS even awaited harsh sentences and prison time, and not to mention that they were treated way worse in the prisoner camps. Some were straight up given the choice of either 20 years in prison or 5 years in the Legion. For a 17-year-old in the SS, this was a good deal. Even for the hardest anti-French German National Socialist, the choice between borderline starving for 20 years and fighting for your former enemy for 5 became quite a trivial and easy choice. For the Wehrmacht POWs, the ideological conflict was even less relevant. Additionally, the Wehrmacht also experienced bad conditions in prison camps, but opposed to the SS men, who were treated poorly often on purpose, all of France in general had food shortages right after the war. Even though the starving conditions were accidental, it is charitable to say that the Legion was not opposed to integrating this into their marketing campaign, as this quote shows.
Sie haben uns erst in der Kriegsgefangenschaft weich gemacht. Dann strichen bestellte Mädchen in dünnen Georgette-Blusen, kurzen Röcken und nichts darunter um den Stacheldraht. Die kauten Weißbrot oder schmissen die angerauchten Galois einen Meter vor den Draht. Da sollte unser eins nicht den Lagerkoller kriegen. Wir schrien wie verrückt, Mert, und unterschrieben den Revers für die Legion.
Looking for ideological reasons here is rather useless, but serving for the French was not particularly too contradictory. Most of them grew up in the Hitler Youth, so the idea of European rulers of quote-unquote foreign hordes was not too alien for them. They could see themselves as defenders of European interests. All this together led to a largely successful propaganda campaign by the Legion. And very quickly, most divisions of the Legion were up to 50% German, when they were only allowed to be, at the highest, around 30% one ethnicity. This was troublesome for the French law officers too. They just got their nation humiliated in World War II and now not only had to train, but also lead their former enemies into battle only a couple of months after the end of the war. To dissect the motivation of why the Wehrmacht and SS veterans joined the Legion is a complicated task, but one thing that can be said easily is that the material need was the primary motivator here. Later reasons like adventurism, addiction to war, was not particularly present among the men who already fought in a losing total war scenario for multiple years. Many of them also already were in the middle of their lives, had wives and jobs and even careers and families in Germany. This first wave of German POW legionnaires, own accounts at least, of why they joined largely only mentioned the material needs. But if they just stated that to not be judged once they return home, is probably also part of the reason. In 1948, all German prisoners of war besides war criminals were released, and finally could return to Germany. This also marks a shift in motivation as for why people wanted to join. With this began the second wave of recruits for the Legion, the new West German youth.
Hallo Männer, der tollste Hit. Neues Brisk! Neues Brisk!
The media panic of the Legion basically abducting young people into it was a quite common myth. The reality of this was rather different though. The term abduction is rather controversial, but it is true that a large chunk of young people with no jobs existed. In around May of 1950, it was around 472,000 jobless young teens, the hidden number probably being way higher. Leftist parties in Germany said that around 230,000 young men were abducted into the Legion. This varied slightly from the real number of 40,000. The economic poverty of the German youth was something the Legion was very much aware of, but by far not the only thing they used in their advertising. The Legion was everywhere, in novels, media and radio. This subtle propaganda worked, and every German young man at one point was aware that the Legion was an alternative path they could take, as this quote shows from a young German man at the time.
Als ich während der Zeit im Ruhrgebiet durch Gespräch und Unterhaltung von der Legion hörte, entstand so langsam die Idee, mich dorthin zu melden. Meine Gesprächspartner wussten zwar nicht viel über die fremden Legionen, aber einige Punkte tauchten immer wieder auf. Um sie kreisten die Gespräche. Abenteuer, gutes Geld und gemeinsame Erlebnisse.
That the Legion stretched the truth sometimes far enough that it could be considered lying should not be shocking. In a mining community, the recruiters for the Legion said that everyone would get 5,000 West marks and there was no combat drilling anymore, but instead wine and dinners. For everyone in the end, most of the quote-unquote true abduction stories that were in the media at the time were lies or excuses parents used to mentally cope with why their sons escaped the Legion. The best example is Heinz B., a teenager that joined the Legion in 1948 and died in Indochina in 1949. The family claimed he was abducted. In reality, he was sexually molested by his aunt and she threatened, if he ever told anyone, that she would say that he raped her. His answer to the situation was escaping to the Legion. Direct statistics about this time are complicated, but one from a horde of young men captured near the West German border was that around 40% stated that they went for the Legion for adventure lust. Another Swiss statistic says that 50% tried to escape some crime, 35% cause of family problems, and 15% escaped for an adventure and war lust. So which of these is true is debatable, and maybe it depends on the country. So the myth that the majority of Germans in the French Foreign Legion were hardened as S-men and Wehrmacht soldiers is only partially correct. A large chunk of them was young men who only participated in the Hitler Youth or extremely late in the war. But in the end, all these mixed up and became the one cultural trope of the quote-unquote Germans in the Legion. With this mixing of both groups, the myths and stereotypes that developed can be explained. A 17-year-old adventure-hungry teen gets grouped up with a 34-year-old man who fought partisans for 3 years in the Eastern Front. Therefore, contradictory behaviors like extreme brutality and homesickness can come together, because the quote-unquote Germans in the Legion were not just one homogenous bloc. Often people also lied to fit in better with the other Germans. There are accounts of people making up that they were hardened SS-men or they did war crimes in the Eastern Front, just to seem more tough. This can explain a lot of stereotypes that seem more mythical than historical reality. With now knowing how Germans got into the Legion, we can now inspect how they actually dealt with the war, how they dealt with the combat, and how they reflected on the brutality of it. Indochina was different than what even the most experienced anti-partisan fighters of the Wehrmacht knew. This one good quote gives an introduction to the scenario.
Als Frontsoldat der deutschen Wehrmacht hatte ich während des Krieges so etwas nicht erlebt. In Vietnam gab es keine Front, keinen Stellungskrieg. Das war ein richtiger Partisanenkrieg, von dem wir keine Ahnung hatten.
The Legion also felt that they were fighting this war alone. The colonial troops had a horrible reputation of being unreliable. The Legion also had a way higher percentage of casualties, with the Legion having a casualty rate of 21%, compared to the standard of the French of 15%, even though they were better trained. The reason is simple. They were sent into the actual dangerous search and destroy missions, which led to them being the group that got ambushed the most. In the famous Battle of Dien Bien Phu, this reaches its peak, that laid the foundations of the Germans establishing themselves as the main fighting corps. In the battle of German legionnaires and French paratroopers were overrun by Vietnamese forces, while the French colonial troops surrendered right at the beginning of the battle. The Germans and French paras kept fighting utterly outnumbered. Peter Scholl, a soldier in the battle, said the Germans volunteered to die like in a mythical battle of the Goths. Battles like this were very rare though and only happened late in the war. There were no, on average at least, no clear front lines. They were mostly fighting people in civilian clothing. The enemy had no aerial superiority, tanks or even large-scale artillery, but still somehow managed to give the legionnaires an immense feeling of being forced into a corner. The Vietnamese also had no issues purposefully baiting the legionnaires at striking civilians, only at then to recruit from the survivors. This led in return to legionnaires not only feeling like they fight actual soldiers, but that they fight the entire population. Because of those two vastly different target groups, the West German youth and the hardened Wehrmacht veterans, the descriptions of the general situation often seem contradictory. From hardened combat reports to extremely naive behavior like homesickness. That's also how the Legion quickly took forms of a maternal organization. This is seen especially on the example of how different the officers treated the young Germans depending on their origin. Meanwhile, for all the Germans, who by the time of the late Indochina War and the Algeria War became lower officers already and saw their own men simply as a job, a mercenary career, and were therefore rather tough on them, many French officers, on the other hand, saw the Legion at this point almost like an orphan house. Things like gifting each other Christmas gifts, celebrations, all started to get normalized. This also began a spiral of brutality among the Legionnaires. The family structure allowed extremely high levels of loyalty and camaraderie and very little empathy for the foreign Vietnamese. This added on with the extremely young soldiers mixed with Wehrmacht soldiers, both raised in the Hitler Youth, amplified this considerably. Therefore, the nationalist and colonialist education of France and the Hitler Youth found their historical common ground here.
Carte Blanche war für uns das Größte. Alle niedermachen. Verbrannte Erde, ganz klar. Aber wir durften das, ohne bestraft zu werden. Wir sahen das nicht so eng und unsere Offiziere ebenso wenig. Die machten es uns sogar vor. Vieles war natürlich verboten, ganz klar. So, war verboten, sicher. Dass es trotzdem gemacht wurde, ist eine andere Sache.
The Order of Carte Blanche was seen as a privilege. When comparing the passionate and motivated descriptions of Germans with English volunteers like John Collins, a difference in mentality is clear. English legionnaires described the time as miserable, and that people were only waiting to come home or to die, but this cannot really be the case when looking at the most important number, the reenlistment number. Meanwhile, most Germans recruited from POW camps only did 1 5-year tour. The youth had extremely high reenlistment numbers. Their reenlistment heightened during the time of conflict and dropped dramatically in the time where it calmed down. This seems contradictory to Collins' claim that people did not enjoy fighting. When looking at these numbers, one must speak of an almost war addiction. The biggest number drop in desertion rate happened right after Indochina was lost and the Legion's deployment was reduced to garrison and defense work in Algeria. The profit of getting paid more during active combat days and being able to steal from the local population obviously aided this, but also shows that people were not sad and dreadful over their job all the time. That especially among Germans this form of quote-unquote war addiction was present shows itself easily when numbers are put into context. After Indochina, where the Legion was perceived as boring and non-combative, 70% of all deserters were German, even though in 1955 they only made up 46% of the Legion. This also, of course, was related to the rearmament of Germany, and therefore Germans had their own national army they could in theory return to. This situation changed quickly though. In 1958, the Algeria War picked up heat again, and meanwhile the French army was only used for garrison defense work, the offensive search and destroy missions were supposed to be done by the quote-unquote important troops. This was the French paratroopers and the Foreign Legion. Conveniently, right as the conflict heated up again, desertion numbers drastically lowered again and more recruits signed up. In 1958, already 50% of all recruits below 21 gave adventurism as their primary reason to join. But the war in Algeria was different than Indochina. While Indochina obviously was also a guerrilla war, it still had a general military structure behind it and battles still took place. The same cannot really be said or at least equalized to Algeria. All offensive action in Algeria was search and destroy orders with barely any hint of real military opposition. It was never more than 100 partisans at most, and on average it was more around 10 men. Therefore, interviews became a core part of the daily routine. The extremely high German amount gave the leftist media at the time many narratives to use. Like, for example, that Wehrmacht strategies were used against Algerians, or that SS anti-partisan warfare was being conducted. While this cannot be really confirmed or denied, the average German soldier at this point was not a hardened SS man, but a young guy from the 50s. But that the higher German officers in the Legion probably used their experience in this war is undeniable. Algeria, while not being a war comparable to Indochina in battle methods, when it comes to civilian casualties and the interpersonal violence between the civilian population, it truly reached new levels and gave the Legion their new reputation of brutality that lasts until today. But opposed to Indochina, the Legion did not have the privilege of being apolitical in Algeria. Even though the war went badly at first, once the Legion and the Para started an aggressive offensive and large-scale helicopter-based search-and-destroy campaigns, they were objectively succeeding in 1961. The government of Charles de Gaulle sadly did not agree with this and planned to end the war anyway. The military's response to de Gaulle's opinion was a coup d'etat, which failed. This is all summed up way too much, but to focus on the topic, the most famous division of the French Foreign Legion, the 1st Parachute Corps, was active in this coup. But it was obvious to everyone at the time that the Legion was more on the pro-coup side of the situation, because their victory was being taken away from them. The failed coup led to the forming of the illegal quote-unquote terrorist pro-imperialist group OAS. They were supplied equipment and ammunition by the French Foreign Legion again, and even in terrorist activities in mainland France, German legionaries were participating. This all was too much of a risk for the government, and multiple divisions were disbanded. And with the end of large-scale colonial war, this also marks the end of what we nowadays associate as the old Legion with its German core. But this was not the end of German mercenaries in the Cold War. The Legion almost does not seem like the stereotype of wild mercenaries. They were a regulated group under a national banner. Luckily, with the end of the Legion, a lot of German ex-soldiers were now out of a job. With the end of colonial wars done by empires trying to hold on to their subjects, a new wave of conflict began. African countries who only very recently got their independence began fighting among themselves and falling apart for resources and to stomp out internal unrest. With the lack of well-trained African officers and military generals, a business opportunity began for our German mercenaries.
Der Lumumba und des Volkes hat sich weiße Söldner gekauft. Darunter sind viele Deutsche. Fritz, Peter, Thomas, Ulrich, Erwin, Hans, Gerd, Heinz, Bernd, Michael, Georg, Siegfried.
The Congo conflict is a typical post-colonial African war. African nationalists supported by China, Algeria and other communist states fought against the Western-backed dictator Tshombe. Meanwhile, this explains the details of this conflict very little. This already gives a better understanding of the situation than most mercenaries had at the time. The backgrounds and how these German mercenaries even arrived in the Congo is diverse and often only detailed very little on purpose. On average, it can be said that most Germans were recruited through South Africa. The stories of different soldiers usually show somewhat similar backgrounds. Previous military training, either from the Foreign Legion or the West German Army, but either a desire for combat or social and political alienation got them to move to South Africa. In South Africa, they were recruited from bars or from the hearsay of friends of friends. For higher ranking and more experienced people, this was a bit different and requires introduction of an important character of the time. Siegfried Müller, also called Congo Müller, was born in 1920 and served in World War II up to the self at least admitted rank of first lieutenant. He is the face of the German mercenaries in the Congo. He was fighting in the Eastern Front, mostly anti-partisan operations, and then volunteered for the Americans and the Bundeswehr in post-war Germany. Going so far as writing a paper on military strategy for the West German government. He then decided to move to South Africa, self-proclaimed simply because he enjoyed the weather. If Müller's testimony is to be trusted, he received a letter to come to South Africa and then in a restaurant was randomly approached by the advisors of Mike Tshombe. They offered him an officer position in the developing Congo conflict. He happily accepted this offer. And with his charisma, outspoken personality, and the fashion statement of always wearing an iron cross over swastika proudly on his chest, he got a pretty quick big reputation both in media and the world, leading to two East German communist documentaries being shot around it. Germans were not only fighting among Müller though. but also under Mad Mike Coare, a British mercenary. The fact that they certainly did not have lack of recruits can be shown by the fact that Coare rejected batches of 200 recruits for the most minor misbehaviors. Müller describes how they recruited young Germans by simply going to South African bars and asking on who wants to hunt N-words. Calling the war in the Congo erratic would be an understatement. The African Nationalist Forces mostly got their support from rural areas. This led to white mercenaries driving along the bad road systems with jeeps and guns on their hands, back and forth across the country to establish themselves as the ruling authority. The enemy attacked either during those village visits behind civilians or in ambushes on the roads. The white mercenaries are not only there as a military advisor role, they existed to show off that the government had access to white men who were seen as a status symbol for the military. It was also to show that the state had control and hard power over a certain area. The nature of such warfare led to the usual effects. Guerrilla ambushes made the white mercenaries wary of the general civilian population, and most of the time, when there was just a hint of one village supporting the enemy, the entire area and village was burned to the ground and the entire male population was taken out. The brutality of the Congo would even make the worst moments of Algeria look like a literal joke. The amount of done by the African forces against the white population in the Congo made even me recoil, and war are one of my main focuses of study. The civilian population could on large be spared this though. The most brutal war the African forces committed, which I will not detail here, were done against priests and nuns. By the people they themselves even supported with charity and education. The white mercenaries responded to this mode of warfare presented to them by the African rebels how they saw fit. Müller stuck to his German roots and did not make it a big secret that he ravaged entire regions and burned villages down. He also hordes of civilians and after a while started using more drawn out instead of bullets because of what African soldiers on his side taught him. In his words, he did this to let the people know that the white man was here. Müller was the officer of Commando 5/2. Mad Mike Coare led all of Commando 5 and had a rather different personality to Müller. Coare was the opposite of Müller in many ways, rather pragmatic in nature. The German journalist and medic Hans Germani traveled with Coare and gives the biggest insight into the general situation. If his report is to be believed, then Coare did not burn down villages, even in response to the worst done by the rebels. Even when his own soldiers threatened to revolt if they couldn't. Müller's reputation in the Wehrmacht also attracted a certain type of German to come to his division. Radical and mostly vague anti-communism was the mentality of every soldier. They justified themselves as not being mercenaries by saying they defend Germany and the Western nation's interest in the Congo. The motivations for this anti-communism varied from person to person though. Sometimes, right before admitting in the next sentence that they are just there for the money, or because they escaped a former Eastern Bloc country. To the sadness of the East German reporters who wanted to achieve some connection between Nazism and West Germany, Müller and most young men disappointed them. Müller constantly corrected the reporter who kept saying that he fought for quote-unquote Nazi Germany, by telling him to instead say that he fought for the quote-unquote Greater Germanic National Socialist Reich. Müller also stated, very clearly, that in his view, the only connection between the West and Nazi Germany is the anti-communism. Some Germans even come to the Congo because they felt that their radical nationalism was not popular in West Germany or the West German armed forces. And they can be more honest about their views in the Congo. The quote of this young man escaping the Eastern Bloc only to find out that his love for Germany was not popular in the West either crystallizes the typical young German man who found himself in the Congo.
Ich bin von drüber gekommen, kurz nach der Mauer. Bin durch einen Kanal geschwommen. Ich glaube, es stand sogar in der Zeitung. Aber in der Bundesrepublik war alles so langweilig. Wissen Sie, ich bin drüben in die Schule gegangen, aber es ist Ihnen nicht gelungen, mich zum Kommunisten zu machen. Im Gegenteil. Wie viele meiner Schulkollegen bin ich Antikommunist. Ich bin fanatischer Nationalist, aber dafür hat man auch in der Bundesrepublik wenig Verständnis.
Most divisions were not only German though, especially under Coare. They were ragtag groups of South Africans, Englishmen, Belgians, French, Portuguese and Germans. Germans being some of the least connected to the land, and this was noticed by most people there too. The South Africans, Belgians, Portuguese fought for their colonies, and for many people their home. Same for the English. The Belgians even got a reputation for being too kind to the blacks because they, when the Belgian colony was functional, met many of the quote-unquote good blacks. The Germans therefore got the reputation of being war-hungry, violent maniacs along with the South African Boers. This barbarism was not permitted under Mad Mike Hoare. One Boer even had to escape out of fear of Hoare's punishment after it came out that he b***ed an African rebel and c***ed their skulls. Under Müller and the Germans, this was more laughed at than punished. Müller was especially known for his special sense of humor. With his men, he desired a Coca-Cola once, and then decided to drive through the Congo, ravaging everything in his way until he could find one. Müller, opposed to Hoare, was not as successful in military achievements though. Müller one day drove his men into a minefield and into an ambush. He was supposed to only defend Kokkiheadville, but instead decided that the offensive was the best preventative measure. This cost him at most 5 and at least 2 white men, which maybe seems small nowadays when comparing this to the massive amounts of black death rates in the thousands, but for the extremely small forces of white men, this was seen as a disaster. For the rest of the conflict, he sat on the defensive in a military base in Kamina, and only had combat between the area of Stanleyville and Paulus. The dead Germans were buried in the Congo by missionary priests, surrounded by an international bunch of Belgian soldiers and Englishmen in the middle of nowhere. They fought in conflicts nowadays morally judged as evil and historically forgotten, besides for some niche online history fans. Their families often never found out where their sons and husbands died until years later, because the West tried to keep it secret that it had white mercenaries in the area. The Germans either stayed in the Congo as corpses, returned home to Germany and started families with their money, or moved back to South Africa until apartheid ended. How every story of these men ended, we will never know, but at least with this video we will know maybe their why and how they chose this path of life. We do know the ending of Siegfried Müller though, who died of cancer in South Africa on the 19th of April 1983. His last letter said, "I go on the 28th of March to the hospital, where they will take out my stomach and other organs, because I have what they call cancer. Then I will spend 6 to 8 days in the hospital, then 5 weeks at home, and a young, slim man will be back in service." This never happened, and the man who lost his dad in 1942, survived the Eastern Front, and somehow his years as a mercenary in Africa, died a couple of months after this letter in his home in South Africa. How these soldiers saw themselves in the end, and how they reflected on the situation, shows itself in one of the most intimate recordings one could find from these German mercenaries. An East German reporter sneaked into the table talks in the barracks where they discuss if they are murderers or not, or if they deny who they truly were.
Das ist das Komische, was der Kuki hat an den Ball gestellt. Ne?
Ja.
Der wollte mir einreden und
gib mir mal Toiletten,
er ist vielleicht gar nicht so unrecht, dass wir Mörder sind.
Ja, hat er dir heute gesagt, dass ihr bezahlte Mörder seid?
Ja. Er hat gesagt, wir sind bezahlte Mörder. Solange ich nicht dran glaube an das und lebe noch, sagen wir, in einer gewissen Illusion, dann bin ich noch kein Mörder.
Auch wenn du nicht überzeugt bist, dass du ein Mörder bist, bist du einer, indem du einen Menschen umbringst. Das ist eine Ausflucht vor dir selber, mein Lieber. Lass mir erzählen, was du willst. In dem Moment, wo du jemanden umbringst, bist du ein Mörder.
Wir alle wissen, dass in dem Augenblick, wo der kommunistische Fuß war, wird es eine Katastrophe.
Ja, aber man kann es nicht mit diesen Grauermitteln verhindern.
Nein, das meine ich.
Denn da treibt man das Volk ja erst recht dazu. Alle kann man nicht töten. Man kann nicht 10 Millionen Menschen töten.
Nein,
also wird der Rest sagen, was Schombi macht, der tötet, der brennt jedes Dorf nicht, der tötet die Kinder, die Frauen.
Weil du gegen den Kommunismus bist, weil du deine Ideologie...
Aber das ist nicht mein Hauptgrund.
Nicht der Hauptgrund.
Ja.